We made the trip all the way here to Chicago to basically give you guys the best muscle cars in the world. And that's what they have here on display at the Muscle Car and Corvette Nationals. They also have the best barn find collection in the entire United States here on display. And we'll show you that here at the end of the video. This is called the Class of 68. All of these cars are 1968s. And starting off, we have an Oldsmobile Cutlass 442. And this was actually the Chicago Auto Show special. We'll show you over here on the plaque. They called it the Mod Rod. Of course, it was built for the 68 Chicago show. Has a 400 cubic inch V8 in there. But look at the interior on the inside of that car. Not an interior that's a normal for a regular 442. Kind of like a pre-Mysticrome, how it starts out orange at the front of the car over here and kind of fades into a yellow, into a white at the end. Pretty interesting for 68. The reason that we show up to shows like this is so that I can talk to owners of these cars and kind of find out what's original, what's not original, and just learn in general about these cars. And this is no exception. This is a 1973 Pontiac Trans Am, one of 72 produced with a 4-speed. Does have the Super Duty 450. 55 down in there, probably one of the last muscle cars ever made. Some would say 74. I just like this body style a little bit better. But I mean, it has all of the documentation down here, white with the blue bird on it. I mean, what do you guys think about this car? I personally believe that this is probably one of the most beautiful cars ever made. We'll take a look around the backside over here. Oh, Canada car too. Take a look on the inside.
Just as beautiful it is on the outside. This is a car that's 100% on my bucket list to own. I would beat the shit out of this car. This is
maybe not this one, but I just think it's really awesome. I bumped into Lance Miller. Lance, how are you?
Great, man. Good to see you.
Awesome, awesome. And for those that don't know, this is the gentleman that owns Carlisle, a place that we do a lot of videos at, and you brought your Selena 7 here to show at the show, right?
I did. Yeah, I love this car. It's fun.
I've actually only ever seen two of these cars in person. The first one was a silver one at a Mecum auction. The second one, of course, was yours at Carlisle, and they just stop you in your tracks.
They do. They look fast standing still.
They do. All modern supercars to me kind of look similar. When you see one of these cars for the first time, it's just, it doesn't look like anything else.
It is different. It's a unique car. I mean, Celine was always different if you think about it, and this car certainly resembles just that.
The last time I seen it, it had a windshield in it. Yeah. What happened?
I had a problem. A friend of mine needed some windshields done, so he wants to get 5 of them. So on that note, I said, I'll be happy to send mine out. Just make sure you get it back to me for the show. Well, we got it out to California, and I found out that it broke, so I figured, why send it back? I'll just show it this way. Unfortunately, it is what it is, you know?
It is.
Own it, right? Let all your friends heckle you.
They made, like, supercharged versions of these cars?
Or they did. They had turbo cars.
Yep. Is this one of those?
This is naturally aspirated.
Naturally aspirated.
And it says one of two because of the fact they actually put on different headers and also did different ECUs. So it bumped up the horsepower from 550 to 625, so it's one of two for that.
You told me you haven't even been able to drive this car yet.
I haven't yet, and I can't wait. You had said something about it being low. Right now, it's sitting much higher just because we didn't want it to scrape, so I'll get it lowered down.
Oh, okay.
Obviously, maybe I'll even put a windshield in it, and we'll get the motor running. It had a blown head gasket when I bought it, so I'm just in the process of going through the whole car.
It's probably cheaper that way. I want to make it
perfect. Yeah, exactly. Made it a little easier, I guess.
Well, I heard that there's some big things coming up at Carlisle this year.
Oh, yeah, we got a lot going on at Carlisle.
Anything you can tell us on camera while we're here? Is it all going to be a surprise?
Yeah. Across the board, it's a big year for us. It's our 50th anniversary, so we're super excited about that. So we got a lot of neat stuff planned just because of that. I mean, it's a big deal. 50 years in business is a huge deal, especially in the car hobby. It's just good stuff.
Awesome, awesome.
So, yeah, good stuff happening.
Well, Lance, it was good seeing you here at the show. We've just bumped into each other. I appreciate your time.
Hey, thank you guys for all the support. Appreciate it. I love seeing young blood, you know?
I do too. And every time I see anything with you, you're so energetic. You have so much love for the cars, and it's infectious, and I enjoy it.
We're fortunate. Awesome. What you love.
So we finally made it. We're here at the world-renowned Best Barn Finds collection in the entire world on display. It's going to be very difficult to see these cars because these cars are some of the rarest ones here at the show. For example, this is the first 1970 Cuda 440 six-pack V-code car. And we took a look at the Rapid Transit car over there. That was VIN number 5. This one does have VIN number 4, so it was built just before that one. You can see it's also the first 446 pack that was made at the LA plant. They didn't make any Hemis over there. Overall, really, really cool car. I don't know if it was ever painted. Yeah, right here, it says never Okay, so the tag was never painted or anything like that. You can see all of the options. It was lemon twist. Oh, this is Marty. Hey, Marty.
Hey, how you doing, Parker?
I'm doing great. And is that yours?
Yes, it is. This is my 1969 AMC SC Rambler.
So this is a Rambler, not a Scrambler, right?
Well, it's a Scrambler.
Okay.
It was a SC / Rambler. It was a combination product from Hirsch Performance and AMC in 1969. They made 1,512 of them. Of those 1,512, this one, while it's painted right now as an A-scheme and has spent most of its life in the A-scheme, which for people that don't know, is the red sides like this with the white and then the blue on the top.
Okay.
This car was actually born a B-scheme car, which is basically an all-white car with just a thin blue stripe and a thin red stripe on the bottom.
So let's walk that back here for a second, because you were teaching me that the other day. I didn't even know that these came in two different colors. So this is an A scheme, is what Marty is saying, and it originally was not painted like this.
It was painted as a B scheme, which was a much more subdued car. They were nowhere near as popular.
Okay.
So they made about 1,215 of the 1,512 in the A paint scheme, and the other 297, which is this is one of them, was a B-scheme car.
And they have ones that are restored over there.
Yes.
I will take a look at them later to kind of give a visual for the audience. Did this car come with a cross rim setup?
No, so originally it just came with a single four barrel. AMC didn't have the money to do like special performance parts and things.
Okay,
so all they could do was reach into their parts bin of things they already had and put their biggest engine they had, which in 1969 was the 315 horsepower 390, and put it in the lightest car they had, which is this Rambler.
Now, the A-scheme paint, did that come with the 390 logo up
yes.
top there?
Yes, the A-scheme did, the B-scheme did not. So the A-scheme had the arrow with the 390 and then had a scoop that said AIR on
yep.
it.
Yep.
And everybody thinks AIR stands for air. It actually doesn't on this car. It stood for American International Racing, which was James Garner's racing team. Of the
Why it's red, white, and blue?
Well, American International Racing built 12 of these cars to compete in the Baja to run. 10 of them were two-wheel drive and 2 were four-wheel drive.
We'll try and get you a look inside
yep.
here. Does this car run and drive? Or?
Yes, this car is running and driving. I bought it not running and driving. It had a seized, locked-up 343 in it, which is another AMC engine. AMC engines are very easy to swap
okay.
because they're all the same size.
We'll show you the backside of the car here. And I like how it says, go ahead, make my day. I've actually bought a couple cars that have had the same thing
really?
On it before. Yeah,
yeah,
that's pretty cool.
So a quick story on that sticker. I was able to get in touch with some of the old owners of this car, and a 16-year-old kid had bought this car in 1985 from the gentleman that had mini-tubbed it and done the paint work. That guy owned a body shop, which was why he made it so loud. He
okay.
had a business, so he wanted the A paint scheme to advertise.
Oh, that makes sense now.
But so the 16-year-old kid bought the car and then put this sticker on it just to be cool. Well, he didn't realize driving around Queens, New York with a tubbed A-scheme Scrambler with Go Ahead, Make My Day on the back. The guy told me he couldn't drive anywhere and not get into a street race with this car. He said it was the dumbest thing he had ever done, because everywhere he went, people wanted to street race him.
Just got attention.
Yes.
I like how it has either like the raccoon
yeah.
paw prints
yeah.
on the window.
I saw that when we unloaded the car. I'm like, oh, it's too late now. I'm not wiping it off.
You got to leave it on there. I don't clean cars when I buy them out of barns and stuff, because I think they're cooler with the dust on them.
Oh,
and then someone will buy them off me, and then they'll take it to the car wash and blow everything off. I think that devalues the car. What do you think?
It makes it more fun.
It does.
It's all like this car is rough underneath. And to me, I have a really nice 70 Challenger.
Okay.
This car was about having fun.
Absolutely.
Like I'm not too concerned about the paint.
Oh, he's taking paint off it right here at the show.
It's about the joy. The things, I had built the engine for it. So it's a 390, 13-to-1 compression, big solid lift. reflector cam. It sounds like a super stocker when it starts. It's fun.
And you were saying that these are like some special sort of mirror or?
So Hurst Performance actually sold these side view mirrors to multiple manufacturers for any Hurst branded products.
Here, we'll come back out
about
here.
1969. So this mirror was used on this car, and it was also used on the Hurst, the 69 Hurst Old.
I saw this yesterday. I took a look at a lot of the barn finds here at the show. I personally think this is one of the coolest ones. You don't see a barn find SC Rambler in this condition. And Marty, you were sitting here and you overheard a conversation about how this Shelby might be a little bit more rare than we originally thought here in the
yeah,
in the
Corral. This Shelby is a cool car.
So to start out, this is a 69 GT500. I'll see if we can get a better shot of it right here. And you were telling me this is some sort of like pilot car or prototype or something?
Yeah, from listening to the other Shelby guys, and there's been Shelby people all over this car for the last 2 days, this was either a pilot car or a test car, first for Ford for building the 69 Mustang,
okay,
and then from what I understand from other guys being very nice and explaining things to me, this also then went to Shelby and was used as like the test car for when they were building 69 Shelbys.
Okay.
So if you look, the guys have been staring at these marks. There's marks
they're
all
everywhere.
Over the car.
I saw them yesterday. Like they're right here in the door.
The Shelby guys have been trying to figure out where the
right here
what they're for. They think they might have been alignment marks or to measure things. But there's a lot of weird stuff on this Shelby that makes it more like a one-off.
And can you show us some of those things?
So one of them, actually, if you come to the other side, there's insulation shoved all down inside this side scoop area, which on a normal 69 Shelby did not have that.
Let's get it from the other way. That way you can see the insulation.
Sorry about that.
Oh, you're good. You're good. So can you explain that again?
So there was insulation shoved down in here that a normal 69 Shelby doesn't have. They think Shelby at the time was testing for road noise because these cars were supposed to be much more like grand touring cars than the early 65, 66 Shelbys. Me and you were discussing yesterday, mm-hmm. I really love the 65, 66
Absolutely.
Shelbys. They're much more
race
cars for the street, whereas Shelby at the time wanted to do more of like a grand touring car, which is what this sort of is.
And there was something about like the seatbelts you were saying too, or weren't really
I haven't seen it, but apparently the seatbelts are something different. They say experimental on them. There's something weird about them. They were talking about the headlight bezels, which normally on this car are like a chromed pop metal. They're in the trunk, but the trunk's closed. They're normally just chrome pop metal. These are like fiberglass with some type of coating on it, and then that coating is chromed. Like
so
they were test
what he's
ones.
Talking about, we'll go to the front here. You can see, look, you can see it has the little marks all the way down the side of this car. That kind of, what are they, you think they're alignment marks or something?
That's what the Shelby guys were kind of, they think they were like for measuring things. This car also, they said, I overheard before, they said that this car actually couldn't be sold to the public. So it ended up being used at some sort of school after Shelby got done with it. Normally stuff like that would get crushed.
That's a prototype type thing.
Because then up in the top of the windshield too, there's some kind of engineering number.
We'll go ahead and take a look at that engineering number right here. And what do you think that number would have been used for?
I don't want to make a guess.
I got
something
you.
That I don't know. I would love to say, but and then they were talking yesterday. The wheels are interesting because this is like a magnesium center. That's actually, this is epoxy to the center.
Oh, they're glued.
Yeah. It's actually like the center of the rim is glued to the outer.
Oh wow. See, and that's the thing. We walked by this car one time, and I would have never known.
Yeah,
there's nothing that says any of that on this car or anything. And
like I said, I only learned it from sitting behind my car, and some of the Shelby guys were very, very kind and very helpful and were just kind of explaining things to me because I love to learn.
Absolutely.
Me, I love the history of these cars. I got into the muscle car stuff because I love the history of them. I think, you know, every one of these cars has a story, and I love the stories on them.
And speaking of a car that has a story, we'll go over and check out this one over here.
Yeah.
You were telling me this story. And so what is this car?
So this is a experimental 70 Oldsmobile Hurst Olds. From reading the signboard that was up.
Yeah. It's got bullet holes in
it. Yes, it does. So this car
Oldsmobile did not want to do a Hurst Olds in 1970. They wanted Hurst Performance to focus on the Rally 350. And the Rally 350, which I think there's one floating around here. It's a bright yellow Oldsmobile, says
yeah,
Rally 350
over there,
on
sitting
it.
Over there, yep.
George Hurst really wanted to build one of these cars. So he built one himself, brought it to Oldsmobile, showed it to them to try to get convince them to build the car, and they ended up saying, no, thank you, we want you to focus on the Rally 350.
Interesting.
Somehow it still ended up getting sold through an Oldsmobile dealer, and they, from reading the sign, about sometime in the mid to late 70s, it got into a hard front end collision.
Accident.
And during, and then it ended up, I believe, in Pennsylvania, in a wrecking yard where it sat for decades under a bunch of trees.
Well, I mean, I've bought a lot of cars out of wrecking yards in Pennsylvania, and one of the telltale signs is that right there.
I was amazed when I saw that. I've never seen a valve cover rot from the top down, and it's so cool to be able to see the rocker arm through the valve cover.
I've never heard of this car before, and
it was a one-of-one test car, so I'd never heard of it either until I came here. That's the cool thing about this show, is you will see things that you never knew existed.
Do you know anything about any of the other cars here, or?
Well, I mean, you have I believe this is a 69 GTX.
I appreciate you taking the time.
He's
actually been stationed here all weekend. I felt like you would probably be the best person to kind of, you spent the most time in this area.
I was here with my scrambler, and I've escaped to the show a few times, but.
What I like about this car is, they didn't take the rust off of it.
No.
Meaning that you and I both know that every time you open and close this hood, you lose a little bit of your
car.
When
I close the scrambler hood, you hear things move around inside of it.
Absolutely, absolutely. And sometimes people just clean that off, and that just warms my heart. And I mean, it is a blue Hemi GTX. I mean, it's one of 99. I mean, the selection here is extremely, extremely well done.
Yeah, I mean, you have a Superbird over here. You have a Boss 429 Mustang.
Well, we'll get there. We'll go around. Do you mind going with us the whole way around?
Absolutely, I'm more than happy to. I love this stuff. I love these cars.
This is a 409 or?
I believe it was the 348. 348.
Oh, okay. Yeah, it says 348. So this is an Impala convertible, already top of the line car convertible, and then it has the 348 down inside. Really, really cool car. You don't really see white with the blue interior very often. What would you do with this car, Marty?
Probably drive it and have fun with it.
Wouldn't change a thing, would you?
No, this one is pretty cool.
You can fit a whole family in there.
I believe this guy drove this car in, too. Like, it runs and drives.
It runs. Oh, wow, that's even better. And then the car behind us, this is some sort of one of one that I was told, or there was another video that was one, done about this car.
Yeah,
saying it
so
was,
there's a, this car is owned by a couple kids. I met them. They were very nice,
okay.
Younger guys. And so it was a, they think it, what, sorry.
You're good.
They think it was a Mr. Norm's, well, he knows it was a Mr. Norm's car sold new.
Does it have the stickers on it, you think?
I believe the sticker's on the back.
I'll show you back here.
And it was built with a 426 street wedge, which was actually not available in 1966.
You can see it's got the Mr. Norm's Grand Spalding Dodge, and that was like the Yanko or like the Shelby of the Dodge.
And they actually found the advertisement. Mr. Norm's had some really cool ads. If you look through older car magazines in the 60s, Hot Rods, Car Craft, he would have like one-third page ads listing a lot of the high performance stuff. Like when, you know,
like darts and GSS.
Hemi darts and GSSs. And they actually found an ad where he was selling street wedge 66 coronets.
Interesting.
So there's been several videos on this car. It's a
shouldn't exist is what
shouldn't
I was,
exist car,
what I
yeah.
was aware of.
They the two kids that own it, again, very nice guys, and they were saying they think they found at least two, possibly three more, but none of them really want to talk about them.
Well, it probably makes one of the other cars it's not a one of a kind then.
Yeah.
Is that, but that doesn't matter to me.
No.
You know, it's still a super
it's
rare.
It's cool that it exists.
Street wedge car, extremely, extremely cool.
Plum Crate 440 six pack Super B with the Ram Charger hood.
With the air hood on it. And then these are cars that I'm not 100% familiar with. This is a 68 Hurst Olds, and I see it's got red inner fender wells.
Yes, that was a thing for the W30 performance package.
So did this have the W30 package on it?
I believe, and I very well could be wrong, that I think all the Hurst Olds were W30 cars.
Gotcha. Okay.
I think they all had the intake scoops. You can actually see the intake scoops down in the bottom.
That's pretty badass.
It's cool.
That is really, really sick. And then next to that, we have looks like a 70 TA. Now
This is one of my favorite cars here. I love TA Challengers.
I do too.
And this one's jacked up with N50s in the back.
She's a real freak, buddy.
Someone was a badass back in the day with
absolutely.
This thing.
Absolutely. He probably had six packs in the back seat, and he had a mullet when he drove this car. Yeah. I guarantee it. This is pretty cool. We'll see if there's a trunk in it. Can't really tell. Oh, it's got all the awards and the trophies. See if there's a date on any of those.
I think the one was from the early 90s.
I was going to say, it says 1992 on there, but I'm with you. I love AAR Cudas. I love TA Challengers. This is...
And they're so cool that they were 340, they were 340s with 3.2 barrels on them.
Oh, it is an automatic car.
You have the six pack set up on the 340.
And then this also would have had the Trans Am tag on it as well.
Yep.
I had a TA, or not a TA, I had an AAR Cuda at one time.
You?
Yeah, it actually had a lace style hood. Someone had painted it.
Oh, that's
it
was, cool. That's neat.
That was pretty badass. We got a 68 Charger behind us, just a 440 car. That's one of a couple Chargers that they have here. Yeah. There's a 70 over here.
A lot of B-bodies getting found.
We'll take a look at the... '59 Corvette. This is pretty cool. Doesn't look like it was ever hit or anything like that.
Corvettes don't get hit, they get cracked.
That's right. That is right. We have another 70 Charger. We have another RT Challenger.
This is
here.
A 71 446 pack.
Shaker
hood car.
You like the 70s or the 71s better?
I have a 70. Personally, I prefer the front end, the front and the tail end of the 70.
Okay.
They're cool cars. I mean, they're awesome cars, but I love the look of the 70s.
And is this a rare color?
I forget what
Being Dodge, a Challenger guy, I figured I'd ask.
I believe what Dodge called, I believe this was Top Banana. Yeah, Y1 Banana.
I was gonna say, I see a lot of Challengers, I don't really see them in this color.
No, it's a bright color.
Let alone with-
You had to really want attention in 1971.
And then this car, this is actually a really, really, really rare car.
Is it?
Yeah.
I'm not as much of a GM guy as I am a Mopar and an AMC guy. So what can you tell me about this?
I don't know a whole lot. I do know it's the WW5, which would have been the 455 in 1972. See, we're getting into the 72. You know, that's when all the oil crisis, everyone was trying to go smaller with the engine. This is basically like the best, fastest Pontiac that you could get in 72.
Okay.
You see here, it says one of 209, says one of 34 left known to exist. I'm not, like I said, 100% on everything, but I think this one had like a 12-bolt rear end. We'll check that out.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so it does have a 12-bolt rear end underneath this one. Yeah, you can.
Yeah, it's 12-bolt.
12-bolt? That's what I thought, yeah. Super, super rare car.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The sway bar on there is actually unique for this car, too.
Okay.
It's a inch and an eighth diameter. This is the only sway bar that Pontiac ever put on that big diameter.
Okay.
Most of the sway bars on Pontiacs are only like less than an inch. They're much smaller.
And where did you find this car?
So somebody advertised it for sale.
And did you know what it was originally? Or?
I knew pretty much what it was.
One last question for you. Would you say this was probably one of the fastest cars in 72?
Yeah, absolutely.
I would say that with the 455. Thank you for your time. Marty, we'll go over here and check out probably the most famous car at the show.
Yeah, probably. So it's 1970 Superbird. This is a 446 pack car. And
you could have had the Hemi or the 440.
Yeah, you had 444 barrel, 446 pack, or 426 Hemi. Most of them were 444 barrels because Chrysler literally just had to build them to satisfy the NASCAR requirement.
Okay.
There's so many more Superbirds, and there are Daytonas, because NASCAR changed the rules in 1970 to try to dissuade manufacturers from building these.
We'll take a peek on the inside there, and you see one of these come up every so often. You know, I've seen a couple barn find. They kind of lose their luster a little bit when you've seen a few of them, but they're really, really cool. They really are.
I feel like guys knew they were going to be something special early on, so a lot of them got saved.
In our area, there's probably three or four that look just like this or in original paint condition.
Yeah.
But what there's not in our area is that one right there.
No.
That is a 70. Is it a 70? Oh, 69.
69.
Yep, 60. You know what? I should have known, but there's no hood scoop on the top of this one.
So. I was going off the headlights.
Okay. But yeah, this is, you can see here that, now you know this, Marty, but they took the inner fender wells and kind of pushed them back a little bit.
Carved them out.
Yep, and that was to put this motor in it right here. This is the old Boss 429.
So there's actually two different flavors of Boss 429.
Oh.
There is T code and S code.
See, I don't know that.
This one is a T. The early 69s came with an S code, which was, they had magnesium valve covers. They were actually hotter engines.
We'll take a look at this car, and I love Boss 429s. I don't know about you.
They're cool. I am not the world's biggest Mustang guy. I love these Boss 9s.
I've always made money buying and selling Mustangs, so you kind of have to like them.
Yeah.
You know, but we're missing a horn on this one. That's okay, though.
It's funny, if you read the articles from the time when these cars were new, old hot rods, they hated these cars. Well, they did not run well from the factory.
The thing is the real Mustang guys that I know, the big block Shelbys and these Boss Mustangs, they say that they're dogs, they're slow, they come off the line too slow. They like the small block versions a little bit better from the guys that I talk to, at least. But I want to kind of get the inside of this car and show them that this had a rear sway bar,
yes,
as well as the Pontiac that we just talked about over there.
The rear sway bar on these cars was actually, they were the only Mustangs in 1969 to get a rear sway bar.
It was the first Mustang to ever get a sway bar. You just don't see barn find Bosses, and they have every color here imaginable.
I believe they use special bolts for that sway bar too. It was from a company called Super Titanium.
Interesting.
And because I have a friend of mine that's restored several, and one day he was explaining to me there was a company called Super Titanium. There's six bolts on this car made out of titanium, and there's one guy that has them, that if you're restoring a Boss 9 and need those bolts, he bought the stock when the company went out of business and holds on to all those bolts.
They're probably worth a fortune now.
My friend said it was like $400 for the six bolts.
Oh my goodness. And this is a, looks like a Super B or a Cornette. I guess it would be a Cornette because it's RT.
Yeah, I believe it's a Hemi Cornette.
Yep, 69 Dodge Cornette. Oh yeah, you're right, it does have the Hemi in it. Are you a Cornette guy or are you a Super B guy?
I'm a Super B guy personally. I love the side scoops on a Super B, like the A12 cars, the lift-off hood cars.
Oh my God,
I love the Super Bs.
Other than Camaros, if I could have an A12 sitting in the garage, I would be a happy man.
Has to be a four-speed car.
Oh, absolutely. Has to be orange, in my opinion, with the black hood. What would your color
black.
Be?
Black.
Black?
Ooh.
Black.
Ooh.
And of course, we have the Shelby GT500 behind us here, and I don't know if you can hear us with the...
Yeah.
We have a lot of videos on Shelby's on the channel, so we won't get too in depth with this one.
Okay.
But what, you know anything about this car behind us?
This is I believe it was a special order pink Super B.
That's okay, we can skip it.
Yeah.
And the last car here that we kind of both agree on, Marty, is this 1970 Buick GS. Could be in, I think it's the best barn find here.
It's probably my favorite car here. These things are just cool. I always like these cars. They tie everything in. Buick did a lot of marketing with the Apollo space program. So like the paint is Saturn yellow. The other color that was available was white, but it was called Apollo white. The engine is a stage one, ties to Rocket. So I just thought it was always cool how they, you know, the space program, which was putting men on the moon at the time, it was just so cool to me how they tied everything in to that.
I did not know that.
the striping's cool on these cars, the spoiler's
cool.
The hood tack. It's just a neat car in general. You know, the if you look, it's got, you know, working air induction. You know, they
Oh, and it has air conditioning too.
Yeah.
These were
gentlemen's muscle cars. This was an expensive car when it was built. This was a north of $5,000 car when it was built.
Oh wow.
Which is funny because it doesn't sound like much today, but for 1970, you could buy a lot of car for $5,000, and somebody was buying this bright yellow Buick.
We've been to a lot of different car shows in the last year, and I'll be honest with you, this is the only Buick GSX that I've seen.
Really?
Yep.
Really?
Yeah, I don't know how many they made, but they're definitely a really, really rare
neat
piece.
Cars.
If you guys enjoyed Marty's presence on this video, give us a thumbs up, and we'll continue on with the rest of the show. One of the cool things that they do here at Muscle Cars and Corvette Nationals is they have a display here for future generations in the muscle car world, meaning that people that are like my age or younger that are able to bring cars and display them at the show. For example, this is a 1970 Dodge Super B. We're not really going to go over the importance of each car in this section, but you can see that this car is owned by a 14-year-old. He's got me beat, guys, by about a year on owning a classic car, and this is the car that won the Shining Star Award for 2023. You can see that it is owned by a 15-year-old. It's a 1965 Barracuda. We'll take a look at the outside. I like how the front end's not painted. Kind of has like a super stock vibe to it. Just overall, really, really, really cool 65 Barracuda. So we stumbled into Marty on this side of the show again, and he's actually gonna teach us a little bit about cars that I don't know anything about, and that's the AMCs. And if you guys have any like rare AMC parts or anything like that, get a hold of me. I'm sure that Marty would love to purchase them, or you're telling me something about that, or?
I love collecting old AMC racing parts, performance parts, and day two stuff. I love the day two stuff, how those cars were used and beat on in the 70s. So I'm always looking for neat performance stuff from back in the day.
There you go, guys. If you guys have any old AMC performance parts, Marty's your guy. And what are we looking at here,
Marty? So this one right here, this is a 70 AMX. So 68, 69, and 70. They were two-seat cars. They were two-seater AMXs. This one has a 360, and I believe, and an automatic.
Okay, so time out here.
Okay.
70 is the only year for the AMX that has two seats. Is that,
no,
did I hear that 68, correctly?
No, 68, 69, and 70.
Okay.
Those 3 years, they were actually the America's only other two-seat car besides the Corvette.
Interesting.
They were basically the Corvette's competition.
And how do you know that this is a 70 other than the plaque down there?
The grill is the easiest way to tell.
Gotcha.
For me, the grill is the easiest way to tell because that's a 70-style grill, how it jets out. Whereas a 68 or a 69, which I actually don't think they have any
okay,
here.
Okay, so it jets the, out, that's a 70.
The grill is inset back under the hood.
Interesting, so, I appreciate that, Marty. See, I'm learning.
This car also has 360 badges. So in 68 or 69, these could have had a 290, a 343, or a 390. So in 1970, they raised the deck height slightly on the AMC V8.
Okay.
And what that did was they added displacement. So a 290 went to a 304, a 343 went to a 360, but the 390 stayed the same. In 71, they went to the 401, which is a 7390 block is a very special block. It's a one-year-only engine block that is probably the most valuable AMC engine block.
7390, gotcha.
So okay. This one is a 360 automatic.
Same wheels as the machine? Rebel
no, these are not machine wheels.
Okay.
There's a car down there. So after, I believe, January of 70.
By the way, I made a video about the machine. It's a YouTube short, and Marty here commented on it and told me I was wrong. That's why we're here talking about AMZs. So
in January, I believe, of 1970, you could order machine wheels on any intermediate-sized or larger, I believe, AMC product. So
gotcha.
You could order machine wheels on an AMX or a Javelin. They were, I believe the code for them was like special machine steel wheel or styled steel machine wheel.
And we'll see that here shortly.
Yeah, there's a 71 down there.
What's special about this one?
So this is one of my favorite cars in the show. This is a 1970 Javelin Trans Am edition. They built 100 of these cars to commemorate Mark Donohue and the Trans Am racing team for 1970. It has the paint scheme of those race cars.
We'll go down and take a look at that.
All of them were 394 speeds. They had special chin spoilers and special rear spoilers
on
them.
See that chin spoiler down there? I never knew that. That's pretty cool. And then the back spoiler is different?
Yes, and then the back spoiler, it's a special spoiler for the rear.
And what does the SST down there stand for?
It was just the option package for like the interior. It was the nicer interior. All of these cars were identical. They were all the same.
And then what is, this is a Marlin.
This is a Marlin, I believe, with a Typhoon 343. So in 67, they painted these engines gold because AMC was so proud of them. This was the first year for their, they call them Generation 2 V8. The Generation 1 was like the 287 or 327, which is a completely different engine.
Okay.
In 67, AMC released this engine. It's the 343 V8. They called it the Typhoon, and they painted it gold. They were so proud of it.
One thing I know about the Marlins that's pretty cool is they have four bucket seats. You can see, I guess the back seat's not really a bucket, but you do get the armrest in there. But that's kind of the way I remember it.
I can give you a little piece of trivia on this. So in, I believe it was 1969 at the holiday Christmas party. Now, Dick Teague was the designer for a lot of the AMX, the Javelin, a lot of really cool cars. The Marlin was a failure, almost bankrupted AMC with how much money they wasted into it and then sold comparatively none of them because they're Marlins.
They are Marlins, and I've never seen one with the vinyl top done in the middle like that.
So at a holiday Christmas party, as a gag gift, he gave away the trunk lid to a Marlin, and it almost got him fired from American Motors because they were so pissed off that he would bring up the Marlin. It was like verboten in the AMC halls to bring up this car because it was such a commercial failure.
You don't see many of them.
For good reason.
That's why. And so this is a 72, it says?
Yes, this is a 72. Easiest way to tell between a 71 and a 72 are things like the taillights. The taillights are different on a 72.
Let's take a look at that.
Versus a 71.
And so this is a 72 taillight?
This is a 72 taillight, and that's a 71 taillight.
Okay.
This car is I believe it's a 401 four-speed car. So in 1971... we looked at that 70 back there, which was a two-seat AMX.
Okay.
So in 71, the AMC AMX became an option package attached to the Javelin.
Okay.
So it was no longer its own separate car. It was just four-seat Javelin with AMX options. It was badges and different. You could build a Javelin basically with the same options as an AMX, but you wouldn't get the AMX badges, and the grill was different too in an AMX. If you look at the grill on this car, it's a special AMX grill versus the Javelin grill.
I'm glad you cleared that up for me because I always get the Javelins and the AMXs confused.
By 71, they were basically, the same car, just with different options. So we were talking about the machine wheels.
There they are.
This is a 71 AMX. Which could have been optioned. I don't know if this car came with them from the factory, with the styled steel machine wheels. Now you can see down in here in the wheel how there's no actual clip for the trim ring. The trim ring is actually pressed in with a light press fit under this lip. It is horrible to disassemble these wheels. It is probably one of the dumbest designs for a wheel you will ever see.
Probably water gets back in there.
Everything gets back in there. I had bought a set and you use a 20,000 feeler gauge. You basically have to hammer it down into here and then hammer your way around to pop the trim ring up.
Split them apart.
And what happens is dirt, debris, 50 years of crap get
road
built
grind
up behind there, and you end up with a inner rim that looks great, but an outer rim that is non-existent.
And how much does those rims cost?
They are silly expensive.
And when you say silly expensive,
I think decent sets now are going for $4,000 or $5,000.
Oh my! Wow.
A decent, nice, complete set with. I know they repop the trim rings now.
Okay.
But in my experience, repop stuff never matches what the factory could do.
I agree.
So, I believe this is another 401 automatic car. Maybe I haven't looked inside
of it. 401. That again was the 71, right?
or was that 70?
401 was 70, was 71.
71.
So they had planned to do the 401, I believe, in 70, but then they sort of ran out of time, so they kept the displacement the same with a slightly longer connecting rod. And then in 71, AMC really wanted a 400 cubic inch displacement engine. Okay. They desperately wanted to be able to have a slightly bigger engine just to advertise they had were over 400 cubes.
Gotcha.
Then in 71, they came out with the 401. And all AMC V8s, basically, other than the deck height difference, like I said, from a 290 to a 401, they're all small blocks. Gotcha. They're all the same.
I never heard of a big block AMC car.
No,
yeah. That makes total sense. And are these special cars right here? Or?
Well, this is another 70 AMX.
Okay.
This is a factory Ram Air car, so you can actually see under the hood how it has the ducting for the Ram Air scoop.
Oh yeah, I see that on there.
And this is a 69 AMX, so you can see the grill differences between a 70 and a 69 AMX. They're both cool looking cars. I prefer the look of the 70.
But. See how it's recessed back in there? Now, I'll be honest with you, I almost bought a black 69 AMX that had red stripes, and I believe the interior was black too also the other day. I think it sold for like $34,000 or something like that. What are the rarest colors in AMCs? Is that a thing or not a thing?
Not really. Okay. AMC didn't differentiate, didn't get that specific with colors.
Gotcha.
You can get down to like body styles and body types and engines, but as far as paint codes go, you really can't get that far into the numbers.
Understand. And so this is the Scrambler that we were talking about earlier, right?
Yes, this is a 69 SC Rambler, like my car. This is how the Scrambler that I had in the barn find section was born. It was born a B-scheme car, one of 297 that was built that year.
We'll walk down here.
Yep.
I kind of just want to give them a better view for it. And that's the hood scoop that was missing on your car.
That's
do you have a hood scoop on your car?
Yes, I have the hood scoop for my car, and I have an actual real hood, but I didn't get it ready for the show, so that hood that came with the car was the one that went with it.
That's pretty cool. It's got the headrests back there.
The headrest was worse. Actually, the interior for those cars were special. It was a charcoal interior that was just for the SC Rambler with the special headrests like that.
I want to say thank you, Marty, for teaching us about these AMC cars. I see this says 67 X code. Is that?
Yes, so all five of these cars here, the five before the other Scrambler, are 67 X code Ramblers.
Okay.
What that means is, again, for 1967, AMC had just released their new Typhoon 343. This was AMC's first attempt for a hot rod in the 60s.
That one has the hood open.
Yeah, so they took their biggest engine, which was the new 343, and put it in their lightest car, which was a Rambler. The X code is in the VIN.
Okay.
The VIN on these cars, I believe it's the seventh digit is the engine, and it's an X. Similar, the Scrambler is the same way.
Okay.
The X, AMC liked using X, Y, or Z to designate their big engine.
Sure.
So these cars are 67 X code Ramblers. They actually built 58 of them that year, and there's five of them here today.
You wouldn't even know they're rare coming to the show.
No, and that's what's funny. Nobody knows these cars exist because they're an oddball little car, but this was AMC's really first attempt at a hot rod. So they put the biggest engine that they could offer in the smallest, lightest car that they had. These cars weighed 3,000 pounds in that, and with that Typhoon 343, I believe they made 270, 280 horsepower.
That's all you need in a little car like that.
Yeah, and like I said, you can see this one real good. You can see the gold paint. AMC was very proud of this, of releasing this engine, because then in 68 and 69, they went to more of a teal turquoise,
okay,
which is a beautiful color. Unfortunately, the Scrambler doesn't have the hood open, so you can't see it. But if you happen to find one with the hood open, you'll see it's a very, very beautiful blue color for the engine, whereas these were painted gold in 67.
Definitely a car that
no one
show
knows
to
exists.
A car show, they would not know it's a one of 58. I kind of like cars like that.
Yeah, and then this is the last AMC over here. This is what everybody knows. This is an A-scheme SC Rambler, so this would be one of 1,215 A-schemes for that year. And they only figured out the number of those cars recently. For years, there's been debate about how many scramblers they built in which paint scheme, because everybody thought they made 500 A schemes and 500 B schemes and another 500 A schemes. And what they ended up finding was every one of these A scheme cars from the factory was hand pinstriped. They paid a guy per car.
So this was hand done then, huh? Is that what you're saying?
Yes, they paid, I forget the gentleman's name, but they paid one guy to come into the AMC factory, and when like a certain number of cars were done, he would hand pinstripe them. And unfortunately, he passed away. His son was going through paperwork and happened to find the receipt from American Motors where they paid him the pinstripe 1,215 cars. So these cars are all hand pinstriped. The B schemes didn't need any pinstriping. Oh, so they were able to extrapolate how many were built of each based just off of that, because for decades, nobody knew how many were made of each of those cars.
And then this also has the American colors for the headrest.
Yes.
I think that's cool.
That was standard in all of them. There are different, it's funny if you look, some of them are a very light red, some of them are a very dark red. I personally think it was just whatever manufacturer that AMC was getting the headrest from, probably just the batch was, one batch was light red, one batch was dark red. Yep. And American Motors was not turning stuff away because of a slight color differentiation. They couldn't afford to do stuff like that.
Well, Marty, I appreciate you walking us through the American Motors section here. It's a section that I personally didn't know a whole lot about, and I hope that the viewers at home got some sort of value out of this conversation. And again, I want to thank you for your time.
Anytime, anytime.
If you guys have any AMC parts, get a hold of me, and I'll definitely let Marty know.